Hi, everybody. This is the Prep Preview Show for prep football games this Friday night, September 10th, and a full slate for the first time this fall. I'm Randy Shaver, along with Craig Norkus.
You know, once again, we are going to infiltrate your soul with high school football knowledge. But once again, we will not be solving some of life's greater mysteries.
Like?
For example, why do they make shopping carts with four wheels when only three of them ever work? Why do they put directions on shampoo bottles? These are the types of questions that are above our pay grade.
You won't get those answers.
We will not be answering those today.
No, but what you will get is a lot of high school football coverage from us. And before we look ahead to a great spotlight matchup and other games this week, we got to look back to an amazing first week and the big upset by Lake City. Lake City in the dark uniforms against powerhouse Caledonia. Watch the sidelines. That's where the action is. Caledonia, a 71-game winning streak, the longest in the nation coming in, but Lake City pulls off the upset 30-13 to snap.
This is where I love the sideline here. They were going nuts the entire game. Now, this was obviously a big scoring play, but they were like that the whole game. Were they not inspired to win this football game?
They really were. And I had a chance to talk to the head coach, Trevor Nairn, earlier this week.
Yeah, the energy on our sideline was unbelievable. And I kind of realized it as the game was going on, but same as you, is when I watched it back, you know, just the enthusiasm and how much those kids were into the game. And that was just awesome to see. We have a great group of kids. And obviously those kids that are on the sideline, not playing a whole lot, but they were into the game. You know, they had a lot of pressure on them. But what they accomplished was completely amazing, to win 71 games in a row and not lose in 7 years. Pretty awesome. So is it great that we're the team that beat the streak? Yeah, that's awesome. And we'll be remembered that for a long time. But really, it's just the game. And we talked about on Monday at our team meeting that really none of the goals that we set for the season had anything to do with just beating Caledonia. It's one step in a long line of things that need to happen in order for us to reach our goals.
I could watch that sideline
over
all day long.
Over and over.
Trevor was so excited for his team, but he tries to put it in perspective, too, that it's just one game. But
one game. So I will say this. With them being such a big underdog and winning that game, anything is possible, right?
Right.
So question, if anything is possible, is it still possible for anything to be impossible? Is that above your pay grade?
Is that too deep for you? Man, you are filling me full of knowledge or the lack thereof.
The answer is inherently no to that question.
Thank you.
Yes.
Appreciate that. And I appreciate Trevor's time in talking to us this week. That wasn't the only big story. Last Friday, how about Blaine's female kicker, Kendall Staden? She's a big soccer star, talked into trying out for the kicking job in August, and the rest, as they say, is history. Here she is, the junior soccer star, the game-winning 31-yard field goal for Blaine as they beat White Bear Lake as time ran out. Check out the her teammates.
Swamped.
Her new teammates, they just swamped her. What a big win. What a great moment. And here's what Kendall, there she is, had to say.
I kicked it. I didn't look up. I was watching the ball, and I was being rushed by the entire football team. And I was... only thing I could think of, I was, this is straight out of a movie. My main thought was, Kendall, you need to stay on your feet or you're going to get squashed. And I was getting jammed around. Helmets were banging. I was getting slapped in the helmet like every football player does. It was unbelievable.
That's crazy.
I love what she says. I had to stay on my feet or I knew I was going to get squashed. Yeah. Now, in the fall, squash is a popular vegetable, but not for Kendall.
Not for Kendall, and not in that situation. No,
but congrats to her for doing
that. It's awesome. And I had a chance to talk to her, and I asked her about, you know, do you want to keep kicking? Is this something you want to do? Because she's only a junior in high school. And she said, you know, I told myself before the season started, I don't want to do this my senior year. I want to be able to go to the games, watch it, because she lost a year because of COVID.
And absorb it.
And watch it.
Yeah.
But she says, you know what? I like it better on the sidelines. That was kind of fun.
You got a little bit better view on the sidelines and a little bit better view on the field.
Yeah.
So she could get used to that.
Fabulous
for sure.
Win for Blaine, 23-21. They go to Minnetonka this week.
I also love how she said she didn't look up And that just kind of reminds me of these pro golfers that just crush these shots and they never even look. They just drop the club and walk off. That was Kendall.
Yeah, fantastic. Good for her. There was another big story, and not on the fun side, that happened on Friday night in Waseca. The head coach, Brad Wendland, collapsed on the sideline late in that win over St. Peter. We're happy to say he's recovering after his heart stopped on the sideline. Fast-acting medical personnel revived him. He was taken to a Mankato hospital. Brad's doing okay right now. He will not coach the rest of the season, but hopes to get back to teaching in about a month.
You know, it's hard to deal with the fact that you scared so many people that are really important to you. You know, every one of those players I've known since they were little kids. My son was one of them. My youngest son was a senior on the team. You know, the assistant coaches, the parents, these are all my friends. And I put a big scare into them with what happened Friday night. So, you know, it's been hard to come to grips with that.
We wish him well, because this was a scary situation. There were medical personnel on the sideline. There was a nurse in the stands. They got the AED. They revived him on the sidelines in front of the team. Imagine that.
Yeah.
And the AD said in a story that we had on Monday night that it was as quiet in that stadium as he has ever heard it when all this was going on.
You know what really strikes me about that interview there is his selflessness. Here he is, obviously in a hospital bed on this Zoom interview, and he's talking about, oh, I put a scare into everybody on the sideline, and I'm trying to come to grips with that.
Right.
Like that's the epitome of selflessness. He's thinking about the people that he scared.
And you and I have both met Brad. We did a story down at Waseca a few years ago on their football team, and an assistant coach on that team who was going through cancer at the time.
Right.
And he's just an unbelievable guy. Just
Amazing person.
Just a great guy.
Yes.
Yeah. So we wish
him the best.
Nothing but the best. All right. Well, let's also talk about what was our spotlight game on Friday night. It was Cooper and Orono. You were there.
Mm-hmm.
It's an emotional week. They lost their strength and conditioning coach, Coach Drew, to a sudden heart situation. Lost his life at the age of 27. Cooper wins the game, but after the game, right?
Right. So it was an emotional win, and Coach Howard had a speech after the win over Orono on Friday night, and kind of in memory talked about the passing of Coach Drew in that speech to the team after their victory. Here's some of it.
Here it is.
Let's give it up for our players for the week that they had. And I say this to everybody that's here that did not know Coach Drew. Coach Drew was 100% about doing things the right way. Coach Drew wanted to make sure these players did it with the right technique, the right form. Do it with integrity. For Cooper High School, from a coaching staff, we're trying to transform that building. We're trying to make sure that we are destination school. Cooper High School is where people need to be coming for a great education, for great sports, for great activities. This is what it's about. So in order for us to do it, we need everybody to stay strong together. We need everybody to hold each other accountable. We need everybody doing things the right way. Because what you saw tonight is just the start of what's going to be special for the whole year. In order for us to do what we're trying to do, we're going to need all of you guys. Is that fair?
Yeah.
Coach Mo, let's get it one more time.
Just part of an emotional night at Cooper. This guy had a great game. Joe
Russell,
quarterback. 20 of 30, 252 yards, couple of touchdown passes. David Connors on the receiving end right there.
Catch.
Great catch there. The running back.
How about Camden Royal?
Well, he was really good.
He obviously made our preseason All-Metro team, and he lived up to it. He was shifty and nifty and all over the field. I mean, just a very impressive runner. And they use him in the backfield. There was a pass out in the flat. Obviously, he takes it the distance. Incredible player.
Yep. So now Cooper High School will advance to this week, and they will play Waconia at TCO Performance Center, the Vikings headquarters in Eagan. A very special game for these two teams. Waconia coming off a loss to Armstrong. They're a 5A team, Cooper a 4A, and a couple of players to watch. Jackson Howard, Joe Russell, and Max McAnally, the outstanding football player slash national wrestling champion for Waconia. So that's just one of the games to watch. We decided on a spotlight game this week that is Prior Lake at Shakopee in 6A.
Well, I love that I get a chance to go down to the South Metro for some spotlight action. I mean, they've got some ascending teams down there. And how about Coach Benton with Shakopee? I mean, we're gonna hear from him in a little bit. This guy is an inspiring talker.
And he runs that offense that we are now seeing more of around the Metro. Elk River runs the T. Lakeville South runs the T.
The misdirection,
Yeah, and Shakopee runs a version of that and has had a lot of success running the football. They don't throw the ball a lot, but they run the ball well.
Right, and those types of offenses are very tricky, not only for defenses, but also when you're trying to cover a game. You got to make sure, like, I'm reading my keys when I'm shooting the game like that, when they do all those misdirection plays. It should be fun, though.
It's a huge game in the South Metro on Friday night, and Coach Benton talks about just the atmosphere of football at Shakopee.
Clean air nights. You look up and you see those blue skies. You can smell it in the air, right? And your players are out there and the music's going. I mean, there's nothing better. There's nothing better than that. Right? You know, you got your polo on because it's right there. You know it's gonna be a little nippy maybe at the end, but it's that feeling again. Energy, right? The excitement. Did you prepare for every single thing that they're gonna do and you know they got a wrinkle? So we only get 8 games. That's it, 8 games. So every single night is special.
And it will be a special spotlight game on Friday night, 7 o'clock. Shakopee taking on Prior Lake. Matt Gegenheimer's got a very good football team at Prior Lake. It's going to be a good game.
I like what Gegenheimer has done with that team recently. They have squared up against the top 6A schools and not only played them, but competed. And I go back 2 years ago to when Wayzata won the state championship, and the toughest game they played was against Prior Lake that year. And I was at that game. And last year they gave fits to Eden Prairie in the playoffs. So a program on the rise, Prior Lake, for sure.
All right, so that's our spotlight game at 7 o'clock on Friday. Other matchups to watch. EP will travel to Farmington. Big game for the Farmington Tigers. Elk River, Andover. It's a tackle cancer game. Both teams come in at 1-0. Creighton will travel to Matamidi in 5A. And then two rivalry games. Chanhassen at Chaska, huge tackle cancer game. And Lakeville South against Lakeville North.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So, do we have the KARE 11 teleporter, Star Trek teleporter, ready? Because I'm going to be in Shakopee for the spotlight game, but I have to be at the Battle of Lakeville, too. I got to teleport to that game. And then I want to be at the jug game, Chanhassen versus Chaska, and they play for a jug. Do we have it ready?
We have it ready. So many great highlights to show you. And then, how about this thing from last week? This is Will Schleicher. It's a 71-yard punt for Chanhassen. It's a new school record. And, you know, it's not your typical 71-yard punt, Craig. It's a lot in the air.
Look at this returner. It was launched 20 yards over the returner's head. But so here's the question. We remember the New England Patriots in Deflategate. But now with 71-yard punts, do we have a reinflate game? I mean, I don't want to take anything away from Schleicher, but, I mean, that's 71 yards, basically in the air.
Yeah, basically in the air. That was a great punt by Will Schleicher, and congratulations to him. Chaska and Chan, of course, facing off in Chaska on Friday night. Let's go back to Creighton for a second. I had a chance recently to talk high school football with Joe Maurer. For those who don't know, Joe was a standout quarterback for Creighton back in 1999 and 2000, one of the best I've ever seen. Here's some video. Joe was the National Gatorade High School Football Player of the Year in 2000, 2001, set to join the late Bobby Bowden at Florida State until baseball called, and he was drafted number one by the Twins. Joe has great memories of his days at Creighton playing football. His senior year, he threw 41 touchdown passes, just 3 interceptions, and 2 of them by the former Wayzata star, Gopher star, NFL star, Marion Barber. How crazy is that? And Maurer has never forgotten that.
Nope. But I remember one of them was a deflection. The other one was probably the greatest play ever seen in high school football. And we kind of, you know, we were going after him a little bit with my top receiver, Tony Leisman. And I remember we were just doing a 10-yard out. And I hit my fifth step and was getting ready to throw the ball. And he made a heck of a break on it. And I remember midway through, I'm like, I'm just going to throw this out of bounds. And tried to throw it out of bounds. And he was able to catch it and put one foot in play. So those plays like that, you tip your cap. But what a tremendous player. And obviously, we all know what he did, yeah. You know, post-high school career.
Crazy that Joe still remembers that particular play.
And when he says crazy what he did, I mean, the Marion Barber turned out to be like a bull of a running back. That's what he was known for at the Gophers and with the Dallas Cowboys. He never went out of bounds. He would seek out contact. So to see him make an athletic play intercepting a pass is kind of contrary to how I knew Marion Barber.
Right. Such a great player, though, on both sides of the ball for Wyzetta and Brad Anderson back in the day. All right. So let's talk about tackle cancer for a second. The Minnesota Football Coaches Association campaign is off and running for 2021. And for one Minnesota football coach, all of this hits close to home. Life, family, football. There's no room for cancer in that equation, or so Trevor Solem thought. Actually, it's unfair. He beat Ewing sarcoma cancer as a young teenager in the late 1990s.
For that, I did chemotherapy, radiation, surgery, and bone marrow transplant.
That's a lot for a young boy. A beatable cancer, but likely all that treatment resulted in battle number two.
After talking with the doctor, he kind of thinks that it's a direct cause from one of the chemotherapy drugs I had when I was younger, when I went through the first bout of cancer.
Right now, Trevor's receiving immunotherapy treatment at Mayo for a rare urethra carcinoma. The protocol basically is reigniting his own immune system to kill the cancer. And so far, so good. He's getting great community support in Minnewaska, where they rallied for him at a recent fundraiser. His family is so grateful. He's a beloved football coach. It runs in the family. His dad, Steve, is the eighth winningest coach in Minnesota prep football history after years of success at Bold. Trevor's brother coaches as well. This is where he wants to be, and cancer is not going to keep him away.
It's like going home to your own kids, but now I've got, you know, 55 of them that I get to see for a couple hours after school, and then I get to go home to my own kids again. So I really, really enjoy it. Eyes up and moving forward, and we are not going to turn around and look at things that happened in the past, because it's not a positive thing to look back and see or ask questions about why me, those sorts of things. So we'll just keep plugging away at what we need to and managing myself the way that I need to in order to be my best self right now.
And if you'd like to help the Solems, friends have set up a Venmo account and an account through Glenwood State Bank. Here is the info. What's up? Mention one other thing about this week coming up. Forest Lake.
Right.
And the brand new stadium.
The whole complex.
The whole complex.
Not just the stadium, the
Look
bathrooms, the concessions, the track, the lights, the turf, everything. And, you know, it's funny, we profiled this on our first show on August 18th, and it feels like forever ago, but it's finally coming to fruition this Friday.
And they're so excited. They host Anoka for the first time, a regular season game against Anoka since 1997, and that's Friday night at Forest Lake, and we will be there to cover that. Well, we're always looking for that unusual play, that one that you can't stop watching. We found one.
This literally qualifies in the ridiculous category, because you and I have been covering football for 58 years between us. What is going on with this?
Thomas Jacobs catches the ball and the opponent's helmet.
But then he just hands it back to him. I love the smoothness of this. Oh, got the ball, got the helmet, and then bloop. It's almost like he's been practicing that play. He just, like, whatever. Oh, yeah, just hand him the helmet. Here we
Fantastic
go.
Fantastic.
This is unbelievable. My question is, does he get credit for two receptions?
That's a good question.
In high school fantasy?
That's a good question. By the way, that's one of our hot highlights that you can vote on the Care 11 Facebook page until Friday. We'll announce the winner in the prep show on Friday night. All right, now we've come to the part of the show that belongs to Mr. Norkus, and it's the Weeble part of the show.
Right. So by popular demand.
We're not sure how popular, but yes.
No, by incredibly popular demand.
Okay.
It is back.
The Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down.
Yeah, the Weeble is a small children's plastic toy. Thank you to this commercial from 1970. That's not saying anything about our age, but the Weeble is famous for not falling down. So what is the significance?
Hey, hey, look at me and Weeble.
Would be Weeble of the Week, and that would be a person who doesn't go down. And this week's Weeble of the Week is Spring Lake Park running back Braden Comer. Why? Because it's going to take six people to get him down, all individually. One, two, three, four. Here comes number five. Nope. And number six. But watch this part. There's going to be a term for this. Even when he finally gets tackled, re-uprightization. That's what a Weeble does. Roll over. Up.
Pops right back up.
Yep, so six people to tackle him, and he rolls over and pops back up. Nice job, Braden Comer, for being Weeble of the Week.
So if you're out there watching the show and you're getting ready to play on Friday night, just don't go down easy.
Yeah.
Don't go down easy. You could end up the Weeble of the Week.
Or if you do not want to be Weeble of the Week, go down quick and stay down.
Exactly. All right. That's it for our show. Reminder, Prep Sports Extra, 10:15 on KARE Friday night, 11 o'clock on cable, YouTube, Facebook, and KARE11.com. It's a full slate of high school football on Friday night. We're excited to cover it. And we'll see you next Wednesday with another edition of Prep Preview.
Enjoy.